Okay, so let's start. Welcome to the talk, what's new in TensorFlow 2.0 towards the de facto standard in data science. First of all, just to keep you awake, it's after lunch. Can you tell me what this is here? Yeah. A bit louder, please, I don't hear anything. A rainbow, good. Other ideas? It's a rainbow, yeah. What else? It's a graph, okay. It's a rainbow, it's a graph. What else? It's me? No idea. So it's a sine wave, or half of a sine wave. And do you see the difference between the left and the right hand side? So what's on the left hand side? How many? It's smooth and there's more than one, no? And on the right hand side, it's only one. Anyway, always, always. Okay, so what's the question then? Any question? Okay, so I give you a hint. The left hand side is training data and the right hand side is the prediction. So that was really impressive to me, because you see on the left-hand side, the training data contains positive gradient examples, and the prediction gave me negative gradient continuations of the correct sine wave. And by the way, the model behind this one is called LSTM, Long Short-Term Memory Network, which, by the way, if you are in that, is old-fashioned. So the new kids on the block are the attention models, attention-based models. Anyway. Who of you is into deep learning in this audience? Can you please raise your hand? Okay, so I scared away the other half. Okay, who of you is into TensorFlow? Okay, good. Who of you is into machine learning? Okay, and who of you is into Python? Okay, who of you is into TensorFlow 2.0? Even 2, 3, 4. Okay, at least some. Yeah. So I work for the IBM Center for Open Source Data and AI Technologies. That means I can do open source all day long, and IBM even pays me for that. That's pretty cool. And we are kind of nice here. We contribute to 10 open source projects. So only our center, IBM in general, contributes, of course, to more projects. We have 17 Apache committers and more than 100 contributors. And we have more than 120,000 lines of code into Spark and SystemML. And we are number 2 contributor to Kubeflow. Maybe some of you have attended the Kubeflow talk before. So it's all about Kubeflow and TensorFlow at the moment, at least in my ecosystem. So what's new in TensorFlow 2.0? Maybe you have, some of you might have seen the videos on the TensorFlow summit, which was this spring. Any one of you have seen that? Highly recommended playlist in YouTube. And I was pretty shocked, so I published a video on my YouTube channel. What TensorFlow is doing? Well, first of all, there was a framework called Theano, which was state-of-the-art that time, and when Google released TensorFlow, there was no interest anymore in Theano, especially since some Theano folks went to Google. And in version 2.x, the Keras framework was tightly integrated into TensorFlow, that's using Keras standalone. Didn't make any sense. So I was a bit shocked, and I published this video, and I got a response on the same day. You see here, I published it on 20th of March, and the same day I got a response from François Chollet. For those who know, he is the creator of the Keras framework. So if you want to get famous within Google, you know how to do it. Of course, on the negative side, but he said I'm lazy and stupid and so on. So I thought maybe I'm lazy and stupid, and I'll take this as a chance. And but he seemed to be concerned. No, actually, some critics I have, he was really thinking about, and for 4 days, and then published another tweet. Anyway, I'm not lazy. I'm not stupid. So I took the challenge and actually was. Working myself through the TensorFlow 2.0 new features. So I was using Keras before, so TensorFlow for me was only an execution framework for linear algebra with auto differentiation and some optimizations behind it. So I never ever was coding in TensorFlow, and still I highly recommend not to code in TensorFlow, just use Keras, unless you are really stuck and you need to code in TensorFlow. Anyway, I did some videos and I'm also planning to publish a book about it, and I also got a pull request into the TensorFlow repository, so the stupid laziness, I think, thing is addressed. So deep learning, for those who don't know, I think I won't have time to go into all that, so maybe in one sentence, so two sentences, one sentence, who of you doesn't know what machine learning is? Or the other way around, who of you knows what machine learning is? Okay, so I won't cover that. So deep learning is just an extension to machine learning. The type of models is slightly different, and the main property in deep learning is that you don't know what you do inside the model. And it's proven, in my opinion, because the main feature of deep learning is that you have nonlinear transformations of feature spaces. So in each layer, you are completely changing all your data points in a non-linear way. And if you have a couple of layers, of course, there is no way in actually knowing what you're doing. But still, it's working out pretty well. That much that the deep learning neural network is a so-called universal function approximator. So it can represent any mathematical function. The catch here is in the word represent, because even if it can represent any mathematical function, it's not guaranteed that you can train any or learn any mathematical function. But that's another story and an area of active research. So what's old in TensorFlow? It has been a mess. So a lot of packages, nobody really knew which package to use for what. There was a huge conscript package, which was a mess. So that all got cleaned up. But that's not the main thing I want to tell you. The main thing is something else. So if you see here this Google Trend chart, I took this today, so it's very recent. You see here Keras and TensorFlow are definitely the leaders. There is some dying PyTorch community, I don't know. Any PyTorch guys in here? Good, nobody will kill me. I did that in a PyData meetup, and more than 50% have been PyTorch lovers. You can imagine our discussions. Anyway, I'm a huge fan of Keras and TensorFlow. It's much more easy, especially Keras. And then you see something at the bottom. This is Theano and MXNet. So in other words, don't look at anything else than TensorFlow, Keras, and PyTorch at the moment. The rest is most probably to die soon. So let's have a look at TensorFlow 1.3 code, and I actually try to show it to you live. You never know, this Wi-Fi here is not the best one, you might have noticed that, but we give it a try anyway. Let's have a look at which version of TensorFlow we are running. So that's version 1.3. And I told you never use pure TensorFlow code because it's linear algebra, pure linear algebra. And it's not necessary to really implement your models at that level. But if you need or if you want, of course you can do it. And in TensorFlow up to 1.4, you had a limitation. The idea is you create a so-called execution graph using the Python language, and after that you execute the execution graph in a so-called TensorFlow session. That means if I now execute this line, I get back a tensor object, but with that tensor object within the Python environment, I can't do anything useful. The only thing what I can do is to add operations to the tensors, and that constructs the graph for me now. So C is now execution graph, which takes the tensor dot product between A and B. So those are three nodes in the graph. Two nodes are the input data, and one is the operation. So now I'm, so don't do that at home. That's not the way how you do it using the TensorFlow session. But anyway, it's just for illustration purposes. So the tensor, or the vector dot product between those two vectors, 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5, 6, let me increase the size a bit for you, is 32, not 42. I missed that. Next time I need to construct an example for 42. That's a good thing to remember. So now if I'm messing up my code somewhere, I get a huge trace, a stack trace, and somewhere, if I'm lucky, I can spot the error. So you see here the error is matrix size incompatible. Of course, in a vector dot product, you have to have the same size. I have just removed one element here and I get an error. But the thing what I want to tell you here is you need to run this graph in a session and then you get the error and then you need to debug. So you need to change the graph and add some outputs. And that was one of the main concerns, especially coming from the PyTorch community, because PyTorch supports the eager execution. So now let's have a look at TensorFlow 2.0. So it was added in version 1.4, but in 2.0, eager execution is the default execution mode. So let's actually upgrade to version 2.0. This means 1.3 should get removed. You see here 1.3 is being removed, and then 2.0. By the way, if you have questions or comments and or additions or complaints, just raise them anytime. And someone with a microphone will run to your seat. Okay, so let's see. So that's installed. Let's restart the kernel, just to be sure. So, and now I should have version 2.0, okay? So now you see here I'm actually using the same code as above, but if I execute the cell here, the object is of type eager tensor instead of tensor, and that's the whole trick. So your code doesn't change at this stage. The only thing is now you don't need a session anymore. You can directly get the contents of this tensor. And also here, the dot product between the two vectors I'm computing, and I get an eager tensor as result, which is of course what I expect. And without a session, I can directly get the answer of 42. Okay, 32. Okay. So, and again, if I now messing up with my tensor sizes, I see here the error and the stack trace is only 1 mile long and not 3 miles long. And you see here the same message, incompatible matrix size, okay? So that's one of the most interesting features, especially with respect to the PyTorch community. Then the second thing I want to show you is some changes in the Keras implementation. So let me actually close this and by the way, here all these notebooks are running in a Kubernetes container as a pod. So I'm stopping the kernel, then the pod gets shut down. And now I'm running this one. So if I'm lucky, I'm getting the same container back. Yeah, I was lucky, so it's 2.0. So it's basically the container from last time, from 1 minute before. So who of you knows NIST, the NIST dataset? Only one? Two, three, four, five, six. Okay, so for those who don't know, it came from a Kaggle challenge, and it's a dataset which contains 60,000 handwritten digits with a label, and each digit is between 0 and 9, and 10,000 validation examples. And since everybody uses NIST and gets accuracies around 100%, Zalando, I think it was Zalando, it's a Germany-based company, came up with a fashion NIST. So It's basically not containing handwritten digits, it's containing images of fashion items like shoes and jackets and so on, but that's the only difference. So did I run this style? I don't remember. Let's run it again. Yeah, I did. So now here, I just leave it running. The for those who know Keras might be familiar with this code. So what you're doing here is basically you specify the architecture of a neural network with the different layers. So there's the first layer, second layer, and third layer. And this is pure Keras code. So this code I could run in a Keras only context, but you can change the imports here in a way that this code runs one-to-one, also in a TensorFlow context. And the speciality here is that I'm running this Keras code within a so-called scope of a distribution strategy. So this means the same code here I can run on a single CPU, single machine, or on a multi-GPU single node, or on a multi-node CPU cluster, or on a multi-node multi-GPU cluster, without changing this code here. The only thing I need to do is change the distribution strategy and add some environment variables. That's all. That's pretty cool now. So I really have to say Google did a great leap forward from 1x to 2x. And yeah, I'm sorry that I gave a bad time to Boswa actually in March. But yeah, that's the Keras part. And then something else I want to show you. Let's again stop this kernel. And that is the TensorFlow function. So it's getting hotter and hotter. I mean, it's getting colder and colder because of the AC, but I mean the oh, I messed something up. So I ran out of free runtime. So in this tool, you get one free runtime, which you can use forever, but it has only one CPU and 4 GB of memory. And I'm just now assigning another runtime to this notebook. So let's choose maybe 4. Oh, but not R. We want to stay with Python. Or 2, maybe 2 is enough. So now we have changed the runtime, and now let's start again. So this runtime doesn't exist on the Kubernetes cluster, so what will happen is that one pod is created containing the execution environment. You see here now this is charged one capacity unit per hour. So and most likely it will have the old version of TensorFlow installed yet because it's a new container. So let's actually upgrade to 2x. It will again take a minute or so. While this is installing, I show you the code. Okay, there's a little math example or task. So a turnip seller brings his produce to the market. At the end of the day, he tells another seller that he doesn't remember how many turnips he brought. However, after 1 hour of selling, he had sold 6/7 of all turnips plus 1/7 of a turnip. And 1 hour later, he noticed that he had sold 6/7 of the remainder plus 1/7 of a turnip, and at the end he sold 6/7 of the remaining turnips and 1/7 of a turnip and so on 4 times. So you can state this problem, a single hour is basically this equation here, and then if you apply it 4 times, it's basically this equation. And I was going through that and was thinking, complicated, what's the answer? And then I thought, oh, let's create a little TensorFlow program to find the answer, because TensorFlow, as you might know, has automatic differentiation. So with any equation, you can create the first derivative, and then you just see where you have the root of the equation, and then you have the solution. So I thought that's a good thing. It was 3 a.m. yesterday. I'm coming from Europe, so I'm jet lagged anyway, so it's a good time to solve those problems. So let's see whether we have TensorFlow. We have to restart the kernel, forgot that. And now the thing is, you can now build any arbitrary execution graph, and from that you can create the first derivative. And that's really cool. So are we on 2x? Yeah. So see here, that's 1 hour of sales here. That's x minus 6/7 of the remaining turnips minus 1/7. Okay. And this is now a function, but we annotated this function here as a TensorFlow function. And now what happens is the TensorFlow will automatically mess up. What? Never coded 3 a.m. So, see, this is now the TensorFlow code which has been created out of that function. So what it does, it reads your Python code and creates TensorFlow code for you. So you can now just, with your Python skills, implement anything and create the first derivative and run it in a TensorFlow context. That's really cool. So let's continue. Here we need a variable. So for those who know, a variable in TensorFlow is a variable, which means during training gets adjusted in the gradient descent loop, and constant not. So the constant is zero because I set the equation to zero, and the variable is x, and I want to find the x. That's a very, very simple Hello World example. And again, I'm creating a function here, g, which is the concatenation of f 4 times. So that's the whole problem statement. And again, you will see something which I should have fixed at night. So you will see the TensorFlow code here. So it's a lot of nesting going on, but we don't care, because here the nesting is pretty clear, no? So, and now, since only, let's say, 40% of the audience is into machine learning, deep learning, I'm skipping the details of gradient descent here, but you can believe me that in this loop, I'm computing the gradient and constantly updating x unless it converges, until it converges. So you see here, and again here, I can print at any point in time in this loop, I can print and have access to all the variables and parameters. So you see here the loss, so that's basically the error. And you see here the current guess for x, and at the end, we should see a convergence, so the error should converge to zero, and x should converge to the real solution. It turns out the real solution is 400, and here we are converging to 400. Okay. So this is, by the way, if you're interested, I will post a link to all those examples later, so you can run that in your notebook environment. So what did I cover? I covered that stuff here. Just backup slides in case the Wi-Fi sucks again. So here, TensorBoard has been changed. Now you can, so for those who are in 1x, TensorBoard was a separate application. Okay, for those who don't know what TensorBoard is, it's a web interface for debugging your neural network training after the fact. And now, two important changes. One, you can directly run TensorBoard in a Jupyter notebook, and it gets rendered as an iframe. That's pretty cool. The other thing is you can monitor your training in real time now. And it has a couple of interesting plugins, and the most interesting, in my opinion, is the hyperparameter tuning plugin. So parameters in a model especially in the neural network, are the weights. No? Okay? So those are tuned during the gradient descent optimization loop. But then it turns out that maybe your model sucks and you need to change it. And hyperparameters will consider everything above. So number of layers, number of neurons, dropout rate, learning rate, activation functions, all those we consider to be hyperparameters. And usually what we do is we build a grid, a search grid, and then we just search in that grid. Or other folks are doing Monte Carlo, that means randomly in the grid we assign values to our hyperparameters and we do a test run and see how it performs. So that's straightforward. So here in TensorFlow 2x, in the tensor board, we have a hyperparameter tuning plugin, and we define the grid, or we define the hyperparameter ranges. You see here a number of units, that's of course only for one layer. And then you see here HP discrete, that means it will either search for 16 or 32 neurons. So that's grid behavior. But you see also here a real interval. And you see here it's between 0.1 and 0.2 inclusive. But every time a round is done, a random value between 0.1 and 0.2 is chosen. So it's more acting like Monte Carlo random. And you can choose either to use discrete or real interval. And therefore, you can mix and match grid search with Monte Carlo. It's pretty cool. I have never seen that anywhere else. And then you have here Adam and stochastic gradient descent as two variants of your gradient descent optimizer. And then you just create this config. And in the next step, in your Keras model, so I'm concentrating on Keras because I'm anyway not recommending to use low-level TensorFlow. So in this Keras model, at the different points, you just plug those parameters in, so HP number of units. You see here the second layer of this neural network has a parameter for the number of neurons. One line above, the dropout rate is a parameter between 0 and 1, so that's the percentage of the dropouts. And then you have here in the compiler optimizer, which optimizer you're using. So this is the only thing you need to change at the model definition level. And then when it comes to fit, Keras supports so-called callbacks. So during learning, you can assign functions which the framework calls, and then you can monitor your training, for example. And those are two callbacks which are coming from the TensorFlow package. So one is the TensorBoard callback class, which actually allows you to collect the log files for the metrics during training, and the second line is for the hyperparameters. And then you can visualize your output in TensorBoard. So you see here you have H params, and you see on the top left hand side the hyperparameters. It's a tree, no, the type of hyperparameter and the individual values. And you can select and deselect those. And then you see here on the right hand side a table with the different experiments or training runs, and you can sort by accuracy. So that's already a nice overview, but you can even go to a view like this, where you have the accuracy on the right hand side, and you just pick, let's say, the first three runs with the highest accuracy. And what you notice is on the optimizer side, you can basically skip stochastic gradient descent and just go with Adam, because all the top three used Adam as optimizer. But then the other two hyperparameters are much more interesting, because you see here two lines go to a low dropout rate and two lines, one line goes to a high dropout rate. And if you then see the continuation, it's pretty obvious that if you have a high dropout rate, you should have a low number of neurons in the second layer. And if you have a low dropout rate, you should have a very high number of neurons in the second layer. Okay, that way you can visualize your hyperparameter settings even better. So that brings me to the whole overview here. 10 minutes left. Okay. So this is these are all the components. So Keras high-level API, it creates execution graph, but you don't care, because you don't care about the TensorFlow level anyway. And you can run the training, even distributed. In the training, you can attach the hyperparameter tuner and visualize your training in the TensorBoard. And if you're happy, you can export your model. And now TensorFlow 2x has a unique model format, which can be run by TensorFlow Serving, which turns your model into a gRPC and REST API. Or you can run it in TensorFlow Lite or TensorFlow.js. And I have two demos for TensorFlow Lite and TensorFlow.js. So TensorFlow Lite here is running on an Android phone, and it's running a model for object detection, which sucks a bit, but anyway, you see, you get the point, no? Can I still get sound? Or is it too late? Can you maybe ask him if I can get sound? I think he's sleeping. Thank you. Because I said no, but now I realized that I should have some sound. So one colleague of me created this. His name is Va. So let's see if that's working. I first show it to you and then I tell you what it is, okay? It's not grabbing. Maybe because of the blue. Yeah? Okay. Thank you, thank you. You're quite a happy audience, no? Every crap I do, you're like liking. So thanks a lot. So this is my colleague called the theremin. So you might know what a theremin is, with the two antennas. So that's the visual theremin. And it actually uses a pre-trained model, which is called the PoseNet, which gives you back the pose from a video stream, what you have seen, and some little synthesizer in JavaScript. And that's using TensorFlow.js. So that one is TensorFlow Lite. And this is TensorFlow.js, OK? And that's the whole picture. And of course, we are IBM. We build some stuff around it. So in my role, I'm responsible to support open source running on the IBM cloud as good as possible. And I'm responsible for AI model training. So I'm taking care of all those things here. I mean, if you attended the other IBM sessions, we are also concerned about AI fairness and about adversarial attacks. So those are also two open source tools. One is called AIF 360 and one is called ART, Adversarial Robustness Toolbox. You can check those out. So one last thing is TFX, so TensorFlow Extended, which Google announced they will open source their whole end-to-end AI pipeline. I would say they are open sourcing and currently building it. So you see here in the middle, you have the estimator or the Keras model. So I'm not going into estimators here. Estimators you only need if you're not using Keras. And since I told you not to use TensorFlow, I'm not covering it here. TensorFlow Transform, also I've looked into it. It seems to me like 1944 technology. It's MapReduce style programming. So I'm still recommending to use Apache Spark for ETL. And this is a pretty straightforward thing, especially if you are on Kubeflow, then Apache Spark is just one step in your execution pipeline, and the next one, for example, is TensorFlow. But let's see how TensorFlow Transform evolves. Maybe in Spark you can use SQL, you know, that's an advantage, and in TensorFlow Transform, not yet. And then you have TensorFlow Serving. I've already covered that. TensorFlow Serving is encapsulating the trained model, and it gives you a REST and gRPC endpoint to be consumable by developers. And then TensorFlow Model Analysis is quite interesting. You can export your model in a different format, and TensorFlow Model Analysis will draw nice interactive charts for you. And this is an example that you, for example, slice your data set and model on trip start hour, and on strip start hour, you see here at the bottom, the accuracy is different for different slices of your data. So that's another thing which is available in TensorFlow 2x. Yeah, that's basically it. As I said, here you can grab the currently evolving book on this link here, and eventually it will end up in a published book. And then another thing I'm doing, I'm teaching some Coursera courses, and if you are especially interested in deep learning, course number 3 is the one for you. And if you take all 4, you get the IBM Advanced Data Science certificate, which is also pretty cool. So the link is here. And as a special giveaway, I have a promo code for you. You just need to answer a couple of questions. And before you can answer them, you might need to follow some readings I'm pointing to. That's just because the number of promo codes is limited, and I just don't want to give it to idiots. I want to give it to people who are like motivated to actually get a certificate. So that's just a little firewall. But you will actually be able to use the knowledge in that quiz for the courses. So it's not a waste of time if you're really planning to do the courses. Okay, questions we have. 4 minutes for questions, so if you have questions, it's time for you.
You know your first curve fitting kind of example?
Yeah.
Train versus prediction. I mean, when I see curves like that, it say to me that somewhere in your model you implicitly build in some assumption about this concrete down. Because clearly you can have a curve that comes out flat and rises.
Yeah.
I mean, what part of your model implicitly
that's a very good question nobody can answer, because I told you it's a concatenation of nonlinear feature space transformations. And when it comes to LSTMs, you even have state memory in the layers, so no chance for a normal human being to understand why. Yeah, that's true. It's just here to, tell you why I'm so motivated in deep learning. I was so impressed by the continuation of the negative gradients that I thought I need to dig more into that topic. Of course, you're right, the nature and the model, the real system can be different, and maybe then you have just not enough data points collected.
This could be part of the estimate.
Yeah, of course, yeah. Which one, which I showed you? That's highly dependent on the hardware. If you're running on one CPU, it's like it's exponential growth. Now each hyperparameter is adding exponential complexity to your hyperparameter search, because it's a nested loop. So you have to be careful in adding extra hyperparameters, or also in the number of evaluation steps per hyperparameter. It's all an explosion. But yeah, we are working for a cloud provider, and it's good for us, no? Okay, other questions? Yeah, yes, question?
Yeah. Okay, so where do you store your brain data, especially if you don't have it? 10 gigabytes, like in Mapping, or
aha, where I store it. Okay, so the cheapest way is cloud object storage at the moment, even if it's only a couple of gigabytes. In our tooling, you could also directly store it in the container on the file system, but you cannot go cheaper than cloud object storage at the moment across all the cloud providers, so just check out their prices. You need to download the data, but the bottleneck nowadays is on the compute side and not anymore on the IO side. So this in the Apache Spark, and especially in the Hadoop times, the bottleneck was IO. Therefore, we had HDFS, but that's all history. You know, the bottleneck is on the compute, so that's not a problem. Yeah? Oh, 1 second. Fitness program for you.
Okay, yeah. I see a little bit of description. Ruby already said, but I forgot to know. Where are the training data coming from?
Ah, the training data. So it's somehow misusing the framework. The training data is only one row, and the left-hand side is a zero. The y is a zero. And on the right-hand side, I don't even have a variable for data. I only have a variable for the parameter. So it's all constant. So it's basically just taking an equation, taking the first derivative of the equation, and finding the root. That's all. No, I didn't invert. So where's my? I hope I have it in the slides. Otherwise, I need to reopen the notebook. Yeah, see here. So that's the function, and then that's the nested function. And the only thing what I do, I'm taking this function g, and I'm setting it to zero. And there is no input data because the only input data is the label, that's the zero. And regarding training data, there is no training data. It's only x, the rest is constant. And I'm using the optimizer of TensorFlow to find me the optimal value of x that this equation becomes zero. So that's the hello world. It's even more hello world than a real neural network. It's the hello world of the hello world examples. Welcome. Another question?
I'm going to do the first one. Okay, so first of all, is deep learning always better than classic learning?
No, no. Deep learning only performs if you have a lot of data.
What do you know?
You count the number of degrees of freedom. That means the number of weights. You take them by 10, and you should have around that many training examples.
Okay. Is it not enough? Is it okay?
No, scikit-learn models can be served by a project called, don't get me wrong, MLeap, or Fabric for Deep Learning, that's an IBM project, which can serve Keras, and TensorFlow, and PyTorch, and scikit-learn, and Apache Spark. But if it's scikit-learn only, I think it's called MLeap. You have to Google. There's a framework which I think, or MLeap is for Spark, I don't know. There's one framework for scikit-learn models. Okay, time is over anyway. Thanks a lot.